Throughout Europe's history, wars have been fought between the continent's greatest powers for the soul and destiny of not merely the European people, but come more recent centuries, the fate of the world as well. Since the age of antiquity, Europe has regularly seen domination or guidance by a singular leading power, Rome and its Byzantine successor having laid down the foundations for several of the states we know today, either through direct intervention or simply wide-reaching cultural influence. The role of Europe's guiding power would later fall into the Frankish Kingdom and its successor, the Holy Roman Empire, but while these states were certainly large and influential, no longer did they encompass the vastness of Europe, nor hold the culture-shaping weight that Rome once did. The nations of Europe were emerging as near equally large and capable entities, which, though not yet able to rival the continent's dominant power, did experience great degrees of competitiveness among each other. Soon, the Holy Roman Empire too began to wane. Its leading dynasty, the Habsburgs, managed to hold on to prominence by assuming power in the relatively young Kingdom of Spain, ushering in a golden age of exploration, commerce, and conquest. However, this glory would be short-lived as its old rivals of France and England quickly came to outshine them, whilst the Spanish royal line itself became increasingly corrupted by inbreeding, driving it to extinction. The Spanish, though certainly a great power of the time, didn't even come close to embodying the same level of continental authority its predecessors did. On the contrary, its rivals challenged it quite effectively, as Europe now had several very powerful states who each held potential to assume such a position. Dominance of the continent demanded a new level of both might and strategy, and such a thing was embodied by both France and England. With the English physically disconnected from the continent and bearing a much smaller population, France remained quite confident the choice was clear. This truth was not ignored by England. It understood that in a head-to-head war for supremacy, it could not defeat the French, and so a balance of power was sought out. Enlisting the help of several allies over the years, most prominently Prussia and Austria, England ensured that French expansion would be suppressed while it expanded outside of Europe. This would have dramatic consequences come the Napoleonic Wars, France's final major attempt at continental rule. An essential beast which for centuries had been beaten back into its cave had now grown in size and temper, leaving it determined to either consume all in its path, or finally perish. France, of course, was defeated, but the landscape of Europe had changed. And as the French once hungrily picked at the body of Spain's empire, so was France now an appealing course for the rising force which was Prussia, soon to become the German Empire. European influence had spread over the years. No longer were wars fought for domestic territory, but for the fate of valuable lands and allies overseas. This had been the world Germany was born into, and like the ambitious powers which preceded it, the young empire stood with purpose overlooking a globe across which it saw the flag of Britain raised country after country, continent after continent. For so long, Britain had seemingly maintained peace in Europe, only so that its overseas expansion could remain uninterrupted. Britain alone could not be allowed to determine which way the world would spin. It came time that Germany too held a seat at this table, whether Britain welcomed it or not. Before going any further, let's take a minute to thank today's sponsor, the Ridge Wallet. I have to say, folks, this is easily in my top 3 best products ever sponsored. The Ridge Wallet is this fantastic little marvel that has effectively freed up a ton of pocket space for me, without compromising my ability to carry my essential cards, cash, and even some miscellaneous stuff like my lucky coin. This streamlined, lightweight wallet can actually hold about 12 cards in its main compartment, plus quite a bit of cash, which can be held either by a money clip or this neat little strap which I opted for. I just trust it a little more. As a comparison, my old wallet was about twice the size of a Ridge wallet and could feel fairly bulky if I was carrying more than I needed. That's never an issue with the Ridge wallet, it's so sleek and light you practically don't feel it at all. What's better, it's extremely durable. My last wallet is still in good shape, but if you're carrying something made out of cheap genuine leather, you might know it tends to wear out pretty bad over time. Ridge Wallet comes in durable aluminum, titanium, and carbon fiber, all of which are backed by a lifetime warranty, meaning you're assured a quality product that'll last you for the rest of your life. And on top of all that, they look terrific. Ridge has a variety of some 30 plus colors and styles you're sure to like, and in case you're not completely satisfied with the look or performance, you can send it back for a full refund within 45 days. If you follow the link in our description, you can get 10% off your order with free worldwide shipping and returns. Go to ridge.com/MonsieurZ and use code MonsieurZ at checkout to pick up your Ridge Wallet today. I have a feeling you're really gonna enjoy this product. Now, back to the video. Germany's continued challenging of the established European order led to an escalating of tensions between its own faction of the Central European powers against the alliance of Britain, France, and Russia, ultimately erupting following the outbreak of a war between the Austrians and Serbians, whose respective allies of Germany and Russia followed close behind. Russia, of course, drawing in its vengeful ally of France, whilst Britain, though justifying its entry as a defensive neutral Belgium, had long intended to support France in a war to neutralize Germany. Austria's Archduke and heir to the throne, Franz Ferdinand, had been assassinated by a member of Young Bosnia, a group connected to and in this case coordinated by the Serbian Black Hand organization, both of whom shared a goal of uniting the South Slavs of Austro-Hungary into a Serbian-led Yugoslav state. Some theories even suggest the Serbian military actively orchestrated the assassination, but this much is up to speculation. Regardless, the assassination saw blame hoisted upon Serbia for so much as promoting the ideals which inspired these violent actors. As such, an ultimatum was issued demanding that Serbia cease and condemn its anti-Austrian propaganda, as well as outlaw, prosecute, and disband dangerous anti-Austrian groups, and finally allow Austria to directly inquire into involvement within the Serbian military and government, and to demote or arrest those with possible ties to the assassination. Serbia officially accepted all terms but for Austria to directly investigate the matter, asserting it reserved the right to conduct its own investigation. Not trusting the Serbians to keep their word, Austro-Hungary declared war soon after, much to the dismay of France and Russia, who believed Germany simply used Austria's war to justify its own campaign against its eastern and western neighbors, and so it did. The Germans, expecting to deal a quick and decisive killing blow to France early on by launching an unexpected invasion through neutral Belgium, instead found themselves bogged down as significant changes had been made to the original invasion plan, costing it both speed and strength, beginning what would come to be years of stagnant but brutal trench warfare. Because of this, troops meant to be freed up for delivery to the Eastern Front following the fall of France never came, extending the duration of conflicts on both fronts. Additionally, Britain was able to justify its own participation in the war on account of Germany's Belgian invasion, creating an additional stress factor the Germans weren't prepared to handle. Despite this unexpected change of pace, the Central Powers performed quite well early on. The Ottomans found themselves pulled in to support their German ally by a pro-war faction believing it could secure the Empire's place as a great power by riding a potential German victory, mainly providing auxiliary support. Now, the Bulgarians had their initial hesitations to joining the war, however understood that they had much to gain from participating. The Bulgarians, like many other states in the southern Balkans, had only recently achieved independence from the Ottomans some decades prior. In the wake of this independence, Bulgaria and its neighbors aimed to retake all remaining European lands from the Ottomans, with Bulgaria contributing the most to the war effort, receiving the largest cut of Ottoman territory. However, its allies of Serbia and Greece moved to keep the majority of conquered Macedonia, which was originally promised to Bulgaria, for themselves. In response, Bulgaria launched a follow-up war against its former allies, only to be defeated and stripped of additional lands. Embittered and humiliated, Bulgaria stood determined to retake all that was lost and much, much more. The Entente initially reached out to Bulgaria, who could have served as a valuable ally in both defending Serbia and defeating the Ottomans, offering minor compromises over disputed territories, which the Bulgarians neither trusted nor thought worthy of wasting Bulgarian lives in defense of its traitorous ally. The Central Powers, in contrast, offered to Bulgaria virtually all the western lands they desired, as well as willing peaceful concessions from the Ottomans. With that, Bulgaria entered the war, swiftly subduing Serbia alongside Austro-Hungary. It would seem the Central Powers maintained the upper hand during much of the war, even forcing Russia to withdraw and make massive land concessions. However, this momentum eventually ran out. As the Russians exited the war, so did Greece enter, lending full support to Entente forces on the brink in the Balkan front. Bulgaria was knocked out of the conflict, leaving the Ottomans exposed and forced to make an early call for peace. Austro-Hungary's war machine was nearly depleted of fuel. Plagued by strikes and riots back home, it soon collapsed as an entity, leaving only Germany remaining. The Germans, though having brought Russia to the negotiation table, had also brought the Western Titan of the US into the conflict, increasing pressures in the West and eventually driving Germany into ruin. But what if that changed? What if in an alternate timeline, Germany and the Central Powers won the Great War? There are plenty of ways in which this could have occurred. Perhaps Germany's initial plan to defeat the French swiftly before turning focus toward Russia succeeds. Perhaps the US never enters the war while Germany makes successful use of resources from the fallen Russia to fuel its war effort. Perhaps rather than invade France, Germany simply holds its Western Front, focusing on underdeveloped Russia without needing exhaust resources on two fronts for the majority of the war, thus being able to bring the full weight of the German army upon France after having brought Russia down a year or two earlier than in our timeline. A world in which Germany's Schlieffen plan succeeds would end the conflict far too early and leave us with a series of events which weren't precisely the Great War as we knew it. The US, Bulgaria, Italy, and potentially even Britain might have been excluded from the conflict had this been the case. We'll opt for a timeline in which the war ends just prior to the US's entry, but still far enough for borders in the Balkans to have shifted and for Russia to collapse. Either of the latter options work and would either see conflicts end by 1917 or 1918. However, for the sake of this scenario, we're also going to consider that everything which could go right for the Central Powers does go right. For example, once Russia collapses, the pro-neutrality Greek king would have no major allies, allowing for Greece's pro-Entente faction to take power and thus enter the war, turning the tides in the Balkans. We'll need to assume that even despite Greece entering the war, the Bulgarians and Ottomans are able to quickly overpower them and prevent additional Entente forces from entering through Greece. Austro-Hungary also needs greater cooperation from its liberal and minority factions to prevent the internal collapse which would have greatly hampered their later war effort. Finally, Germany, if it is to make use of Russian resources, would need to do so without any hiccups. In our world, the occupation of Russian lands to extract these resources proved taxing on German manpower and too slow to make a significant difference at that point. So this time, things are different. Not long after the Greeks enter the war, Bulgaria launches a successful invasion of Greek lands while the Ottomans deal a crippling blow to Greece's navy. The Entente is able to draw on a few more allies, but by this point little can be done. Austria is able to continue pushing the Italians back, even in spite of air support from France and Britain. The Ottomans, no longer threatened by the Russians to the east or the Greeks to the west, manages to repel the British invasions from the south. And Germany, now with well-supplied shipments of soldiers being freighted from the Eastern Front to the west, and without any threat of American intervention, successfully breaks the Western stalemate and drives forward onto Paris. With France defeated, the war is effectively over, and Britain stands down. Post-war, the Bulgarians would gain not merely the lost lands of Macedonia, but the northern lands of Greece as well, leaving the Greeks only the regions of central Greece and Peloponnesia. The Turks too would have benefited from Greece's involvement and immediate defeat, laying claim to the island of Crete, the Cyclades, and Dodecanese Islands. Outside of Greece, the Ottomans would have also made minor territorial gains in the form of the Sinai Peninsula and Armenia. Though this would have made up the extent of their direct annexations, Ottoman influence would spread even further through the creation of an independent Egyptian state, an independent Triple Entente, and a united Arabia led by the pro-Ottoman emirate of Jebel Shammar. All three of these states coming well under the Ottoman sphere of influence, both through the Ottomans' retention of the Caliph as leader of the international Islamic community, and the establishment of a permanent alliance between the Ottomans and these states, along with Iran and Afghanistan, whom the Ottomans perceived as being at threat of British conquest. Former colonies neighboring Arabia such as Sudan, Eritrea, and Somalia would also gain independence at the request of the Ottomans, seeing opportunity to expand its influence into the Horn of Africa through the believed pro-Islamic Ethiopian emperor. Austro-Hungary would have annexed the northern lands of Serbia and all that of Montenegro. Initially, there are of course fears of Yugoslav resistance and unrest. However, come the end of the war, Austro-Hungary would have established a third crown for the South Slavs, creating alongside Austria and Hungary a third realm within the empire, this realm being led by Croatia to ensure the large Yugoslav population of the empire receive its due representation and the right to self-governance, ultimately bringing an end to the majority of violence and resistance which resulted from the seeming oppression of this population. Minor land gains would also be pulled from Italy and incorporated directly into Germanic Austria. For the time, this compromise seems successful, but beneath the surface there are clear questions of how necessary the union is at this point. Austria's strength and wealth are of course of benefit to Hungary and Croatia, but post-war Hungary is reconsidering if it would truly want to involve itself in yet another Austrian-led conflict, which could prove just as devastating as the Great War. Now, Germany, in accordance with the September program, its plan for territorial expansion, which we saw partially go into effect following the Brest-Litovsk Treaty and partition in the east, would take similar measures to neutralize France as a threat and strengthen its position against Britain for future conflicts. This would entail the integration of Luxembourg into the German Empire, along with France's iron-rich northeastern territory, giving the Germans a direct launchpad for attacks on the British coast, as well as allow for the isolating of Belgium, who post-war would be partitioned along its culturally French and Dutch lines, diminishing the risk Belgium as a whole could pose to German security. France would be made to demolish all fortifications between Germany's new western border and Paris, ensuring that it could not defend itself should it dare attempt to combat Germany again. The French would also be made to pay 10 billion German marks in reparations, not a terrible price to pay when you consider the Treaty of Versailles demanded of Germany 13 times that amount in our timeline. Meaning the debt toll on France wouldn't nearly be as severe as it was for Germany. Even so, Germany saw France as a valuable part of its new continental order, and did not want to see it collapse into financial ruin. Rather, it was to join Germany in a new economic association known as Middle Europa, a European Union. This economic sphere would include the newly established Eastern States, the Austro-Hungaro-Slavic Empire, Denmark, the Belgians, and the Netherlands, this last state receiving special treatment from Germany seeking to solidify a strong friendship, as it remained the only neighboring state who might still align itself with Britain, thus compromising Germany's defenses. Beyond Europe, Germany would seize the Belgian Congo as a central node from which it would connect its widespread African colonies, additionally seizing those of France, Britain, and Portugal to fill any remaining gaps. Middle Africa, as it would come to be known, would be the centerpiece of Germany's new self-sufficiency from the British-dominated world. The resource wealth extracted from this region would propel Germany's economy, industry, and development far beyond its British rival in the span of only a few years. Further, Germany would establish an independent South African Boer Republic out of Transvaal and the former Orange Free State, as an ally in the region and additional check against what remained of British South Africa. Ireland would also receive total independence and find itself in a new alliance with Germany, dealing another blow to Britain's formerly unchallenged dominance. In Asia, Germany would assume control of France's colony in Indochina, and with it the French sphere of influence within China itself. The Chinese, post-war having themselves collapsed into a series of warlord-led states, would be ripe for conquest by both the Germans and Japanese, Britain being forced to take a more active approach in overseeing China to prevent yet another rich land from falling under German sway. It's also important to note that in our world, it was Germany's defeat which helped the Chinese to develop a close partnership with the Weimar government, and thus accelerate its industrialization and militarization. However, with the Imperial German government surviving, it would be less willing to do such a thing, especially given China's alignment with the Entente in the last years of the war. As we said, aside from Germany and Britain, Japan would play a major role in the conquest of China, themselves not having been direly worn out by the Great War, nor significantly punished by Germany, would remain a powerful force in the Far East. Still, the Germans would have established two major checks against Japanese invasion of German lands in China, that being the creation of a Far Eastern Republic out of Russian territory, and giving legitimacy to an independent Mongolia under the military guidance of Baron Ungern, a warlord who modeled himself as the reincarnation of Genghis Khan, intent on restoring the Mongol Empire. Though in our world these lands had fallen to Bolshevik domination, in this alternate timeline the continued strength of Germany and withholding of Russia's chief industrial and agricultural lands in the West ensured that the Bolsheviks remained well in check and perhaps even disadvantaged during major battles with the White Army. Of the lands which would remain independent, we'd also see the region of Turkestan maintain its autonomy from Russia, seeing strong support from the Ottomans across the Caspian Sea, who locally would have initiated a Turkification process to foster increased unity within its diminished lands, having in the years prior to the Great War seen it necessary to reform its relationship with its non-Turkish population through the creation of new states and suppression of non-Turkish cultures within Anatolia and Mesopotamia. Having not only survived the Great War but emerged from it stronger than before, the Ottomans may move to establish close ties with newly independent Turkestan, supporting its desired annexation of East Turkestan within what used to be China. Returning to the Balkans, we find Austria attempting to establish its own Middle Europa sphere independent from Germany, netting the support of the Ukraine and Italy, the latter of which would have found itself in a dire economic situation and desperate for support. Austria, however, wouldn't possess nearly the degree of post-war wealth that Germany did, and as such, this additional strain upon the Union would finally lead Hungary and Croatia to break away as independent states. But while Austria's alliance is seemingly fractured, to the south Bulgaria would have been fostering a relationship with neighboring Romania, and planning their own vision for the future of the Balkans, the Bulgarians laying claim to all lands south of the Danube, while Romania assumed a leading role in the north. Seeing their opportunity come Austria's breakup, the two would launch a simultaneous invasion of Croatia and Hungary, whilst Austria and Italy fully integrated into Germany's Middle Europa economic zone, Germany remaining quite intent on annexing Austria-Bohemia in due time. The Bulgarians, now holding behind them the weight of nearly the entire Balkans, would turn their sights toward the Ottomans, most especially the city of Constantinople and the Ottoman ally of Albania, initiating a long Bulgarian-Ottoman war, from which Bulgaria would emerge as a new Byzantium, whilst the Ottomans became reassured of their future as one of unification with the other Turkic nations, rather than one of heavy investment in European affairs. Returning to Asia, we'd find that Baron Ungern in Mongolia, with support from Germany, would have advanced Mongolian borders southward, reaching as far as British India. The Baron and Mongolia's Khan following the path of the Buddhist faith across Asia, with the end goal of reforming Mongolia and its annexed lands into an all-encompassing Buddhist empire. The Baron's success in the region, as opposed to Germany's efforts against Japan's Manchurian Kingdom in northern China and Britain's Nationalist Republic of China in the south, would lead Germany to treat Mongolia as its primary ally and zone of influence in Asia, despite the Baron not holding strong loyalties to Germany, aside from a shared monarchist ideology. Even still, Germany would agree to cede the lands of Indochina to Mongolia once it broke ground in the region, as a show of good faith between their empires. As the years wore on and Germany grew confident in the course of politics in Europe, Asia, and Africa, so did attention shift over to the Americas. Following the war, Germany would have become a chief trade partner to Mexico, the two fostering relations against the US, whom they both perceived as a potential threat. The years which followed the Mexican border war could easily see Mexico attempt to act as more of a rival to the US by exerting its own influence over Central America, though this is likely to turn out poorly given both American capabilities and Mexican instability. However, Germany may seek to remedy this by aiding Mexican development and militarization, as it had done for China and the USSR in our timeline. In South America, Brazil held within it the world's second largest non-European German population, right behind the US. Given how unlikely it would be for Germany to shift American interests in their favor, it might instead encourage a large migration of its people to Brazil in order to further Germanize the nation in a semi-colonizing fashion. Such an option had been considered prior to the war as a possible means of projecting German influence into the Americas without triggering the US's Monroe Doctrine. The US of this world isn't a far cry from the US of our world, at least by this point. Debts are still being collected from Britain and France while the economy continues to grow. A depression can be expected, however, without the instability of Germany and Europe, who took out American loans to pay off its reparations to France and Britain, who in turn used that American loaned money to pay off their own debts to the US, creating an unstable monetary cycle. The depression remains exclusive to the US, never bleeding over into Europe, thus allowing Britain to prop up the Americans as to prevent Germany from exploiting this financial issue. The depression ends sooner than in our world and sees the US and UK foster friendlier relations for the sake of maintaining a stronger allied bloc against Germany. By the late 1930s, the global state of things would be drastically different. Germany, with its Middle Europa and Middle Africa projects, would have become an economic titan quite literally at the heart of the European continent, shaping its future nearly without challenge. Bulgaria, as the new Byzantine Empire, would be the uncontested guiding force of the Balkan region, holding off potential expansions by the neighboring Ottomans, who in prior years had redefined itself as both the leader of the Islamic world and of the Turkic people. For the time, with its newly settled sphere of influence, the Ottomans would remain content to focus internally until they once again felt the confidence to challenge the Neo-Byzantines. Japan, having overpowered the underdeveloped Republic of China, would assume its role as the leading power of the Far East, being challenged only by the Barons Buddhist Empire, which now held international support as a buffer between Japan and Central Asia. And the US and Britain, having forged the Anglo-American alliance and regained their strength, would continue to actively challenge and suppress German expansion beyond Europe and Africa. The British knowing well that they'd been locked out of the continent, but could still gain the upper hand overseas, reasserting exclusive dominance over the Americas and Oceania for the day when these two global empires might once again clash. And that is where I'll end this video for now. The US of Z thanks you for watching. Support your Legion by liking the video, or join our ranks by subscribing for more. Mr. Z, out.